we walk with the Lord in the light of His word, what a glory He sheds on our way. And while we do His good will, He abides.
Well, good morning, everyone. We're trying to work out a couple of technical issues right now to get the service started, but it's certainly a privilege and a pleasure to have each and every one of you here today. We welcome you, those of you who are regulars and visitors alike, and of course, we welcome those of you who are able to join us online as well. And as soon as Brent's able to bring up the music, all right, we think we'll be able to have the words on the screen for you. If not, we are going to sing Trust and Obey. It's 467 in your hymnal. If you need the words, please do stand as you're able and join me in singing.
Walk with the Lord in the light of His word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly.
Well,
faith can rise.
Completely. Yeah. That's certainly what's not in the hymnal on page 467. I can promise you that. All right. Chorus and then verse 4.
Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Thank you. Please do be seated.
Yeah, that tech glitch was my bad. I looked at the first verse and I looked at the last verse. I was like, oh, those look exactly the same. And then I didn't realize they blended verses 2 and 3 in the original when I put that in. So that is all on me. But I am grateful for a grace-filled congregation that's able to laugh at that type of stuff and still be able to worship the Lord and to trust and obey. So I'm so thankful for each and every one of you here this morning. And so you might be confused. Why am I over here? Why is Mike over here? Mike is preaching. Thank you for pointing that out. Well, you're bringing to us from the Word of God a message. By definition, that is preaching.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. So, but I'm very excited, and sort of the text was not really determined. Like, that's the reason why it says to be announced, and his sermon title is Patience. because he had to wait on the Lord for a while for this message. But when I talked with him about what God was bringing to his mind, I think it's a wonderful message that we need to hear. So I'm excited to hear the final product and what the Lord has put on his heart. So I do have a few other announcements to go through this morning. Tonight is the start of our Vacation Bible School, and it'll be tonight, tomorrow night, and Tuesday night from 6:30 to 8. I am going to ask all the volunteers to be here by at least 6:15, because I'm wanting to take the time to pray for our VBS during that time with all the volunteers. And then we'll have ages 4 through 18, like all the way through high school. So we will have a class for each of the youth and children that come into our program. Next Sunday is going to be our Father's Day ice cream social. It'll be right after church, like right after the benediction. I would like for all of you to head downstairs into the basement. We're going to have multiple different types of ice creams, a bunch of different toppings. We will provide the toppings, but if you wanted to bring your own toppings to do it yourself, that's free. If you want to bring, like, let's say something like chili powder to put on your ice cream, we will not provide that, but if that's something that you want to do, we would invite you to do that and maybe widen other people's thoughts as what could be considered an ice cream topping. But we just wanted to do this to honor our fathers, to have a time where we'll have a special time of prayer just over the fathers. I think it'll be a really good time. Next, we have our trip to the Ark Encounter. That will be on Tuesday, June the 28th. We will determine later this week what the transportation will be like as far as carpooling and what time we'll be leaving here. The one thing I do want to note is that the deadline to lock in for the group rate was this past Tuesday, so we went ahead and locked it in, even though there are some people that were on the list that have not paid yet. So at this point, if you have not had a chance to pay and were planning on going, make sure that we get that in just so we can have the books balance on that. And lastly, we have two meetings. Looking forward to the Nurture and Outreach team right after church, which should be a short 5-10 minute meeting, pretty much to decide what we're going to do as far as toppings. It's going to be a great meeting. And then not this Thursday, but the following Thursday at 7 p.m., we will have our vision team meeting. Is there any announcements that I'm missing from the congregation this morning? And with that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, our Father in heaven, we are so thankful to be in your house, to join in fellowship, to sing praises to you, to be inspired and changed by your word. We take that for granted sometimes, being in your house. May we enjoy this time. May we glorify and praise your holy name during this time. And may we leave changed and transformed to be more like your Son, Jesus Christ, and with the power of the Holy Spirit, be to the world your body. We pray this all in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. And at this point in time, I'm going to invite Alexis to come forward to read our opening scripture verse.
Today's scripture comes from Psalm 37, verses 1 through 9. Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light, and your justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret, it only causes harm. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait on the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. This is the word of God. Thanks be to the Lord.
And Mike and I are going to continue in this role reversal as I will be leading us in this next section of worship songs. So I invite you to please stand right now as we sing our next two songs, 10,000 Reasons and Spirit of the Living God.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his Lord. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh.
Be seated.
Now, Lacey, you're the only kid here, so I'm going to allow you to sit here, but I still have a message for just you and the rest of the congregation, okay? So, do you remember we were talking about a color last week that represented the Holy Spirit? Do you remember it? Does anybody out here remember what?
Red.
Yes. So the red was to remind us of the Holy Spirit, and that was the cloth that was on our communion table up here. But Lacey, I'm going to allow you and you alone to answer this question. What color do we have this week? Green. So what do you think green stands for? Does it stand for... green light to go? No. Does it stand for our boogers that come out of our nose? No. Does it have to do with my favorite football team, the Philadelphia Eagles? Because they're green. No, you're right. That's not it. It would have been great if all the United Methodist churches were Eagles fans, though. I'll ask you guys. You think money,
vegetables.
Grass, vegetables, trees? What do these things all have in common? Grass and trees and flowers and vegetables? Yeah, growth. Yes. So the green on this table reminds us that us as Christians, there's a time in all of our lives where we grow. So like, Lacey, you keep on growing bigger and bigger, and soon you're going to be like all grown up, and you're going to be an adult like your mom and your dad. It's a little bit scary, isn't it? Yeah, it is. But do you know that I'm still growing? Do you know your grandpa's still growing? How are they growing? Can you say it a little bit louder? They are getting older, yes. But we're also to grow in our love of Jesus. And that all of us try to be the best people, the best Christians possible, but none of us are perfect. Like, even your mom's not perfect. I hate to break that to you. And my mom's not perfect. I'm not perfect. No one is perfect except for Jesus. So we need to grow in his love so we can be more loving to others. And that's something that all of us need to hear because we're all children of God. So this children's message really is for all of us because we all need to grow. So let's take a time of praying for that. So, Lord, we are thankful to be your children. And we are especially thankful for our children that are within our congregation. And we're thankful for the children that will be here tonight for our Vacation Bible School, growing in knowledge and love of you. So help us to grow. We need your help to grow, because we know that the world needs to know about you. So help us to grow and to love more. In Jesus' name we pray all these things. Amen. And I'll get you your candy later. So, at this point in time, the first time since I've been here, so normally for the prayers of the people, I like it to be from the people and not from the person who is preaching and leading the service, which for one of the first times ever, it's not me. So this is a time where we share our joys and concerns, our prayers, and our petitions before God. And there's a couple of requests I want to remember off the top of my head. I got a message from Judy Payer this morning saying that she is in the hospital dealing with arthritis of the eye or something like that. So she's getting some steroids. She hopes to be out of the hospital tomorrow, but she would definitely covet your prayers. I want us to continue to remember Amy Smithson, Che, our previous pastor's wife, as she is still struggling with all these heart issues. So continue to lift up them in prayer, especially as they are about to change appointments. And that's a lot on their plate, so they definitely need a lot of prayers. So with that in mind, I invite y'all to share your concerns. Mike?
I would like to ask you to pray for my father this week. Mm-hmm. He has his surgery on Tuesday. And pray not only that the surgery goes well, but that the recovery goes well, that he can resume a lot of the day-to-day activities that he's not been able to do for quite a while.
Yes. Yeah, so continue to pray for Dennis, especially on Tuesday as he goes into for surgery for his back. Because I know it's been a lot of pain especially over the past 6 months. Also in that regard, pray for Nancy as she's having to deal with Dennis and all that recovery and taking care of her brother as well. So it's a lot on her plate. So she definitely needs your prayers for strength this week. So, Lacey? Yeah. So Lacey's asked for prayers for her great-grandpa and for her grandmother. So, yes. Bev? Bev's got to stand. Yep. Yeah, so let's remember to keep Anita in prayer. And what was her last name? Do we remember?
Don't know.
Okay. Anita. Yeah. Yeah, so let's continue to lift up Anita in her prayer as she's dealing with leukemia and a possible move to a nursing home. Carol?
Thanks for
Yeah, yeah. Mm. Yeah. So that is your
cousin's daughter.
Yeah. So Carol's cousin's daughter, Tara. Oh my gosh. So she is 35 and dealing with a very aggressive cancer where it's moved into multiple different places. So let us keep her and the family in prayer, definitely. Nancy? Yeah, so Joyce Adams had a fall, I think it was 2 weeks ago, and I apologize for forgetting to lift that up in prayer last week, but she is at, was it Stony Brook?
The Springs at Stony Brook.
Yeah. So we are passing around a card to send to her, so if the card I can see is on this side of the room, so if anyone on this side of the room did not have a chance to sign and would like to, we'll make sure that we get that to you. Okay. Seals asked for prayers for good test results this week. So this is a follow-up to your surgery. Oh, okay. Yeah. So, Brent?
Joy that Brandon has got a house in Washington.
Yeah. That is a joy. So a lot of excitement there and a lot of nerves as well as they got, Brandy got a house down in Mount Washington. Hopefully this is not the first time Lacey's hearing about it.
She forgot to say it.
Okay. And we want to keep Laura in her prayers as she's recovering from everything going on with her arm. So, Tom? Yeah, so Tom's asked for prayers for all those who graduated just over the past couple weeks, especially as the world is very different than it was even just a year ago. So just navigating through all those different things. Marcia?
Yes, I have an unspoken.
All right. Okay, so Marcia has an unspoken prayer. Mike has another prayer.
I'm just grateful that we have some visitors with us today.
Yes, so... So Nick Neff has finally had a chance to have his parents come down to visit. They've been trying to get here for a while, and I'm so grateful that y'all are here with us this morning, and I hope y'all are getting to enjoy our Mount Holly's worship. So, Bev? Oh, I didn't even go by there this week. I was at annual conference, so just a joy and a thanks to Doug and Kathy for taking care of a bench out there that has been a little bit weak. The boards definitely needed replaced. So I'm as a pastor, I'm just thankful for all the servants' hearts that a lot of these things that the church does. A lot of the things go unnoticed, so thank you for bringing that to our attention and allowing us to notice that. Chuck?
Mark Davis has called us a couple of weeks ago, I guess, this last week, but just be in prayer for them because they're supposed to do surgery for coming, and he's not himself well enough to have the surgery, but it's putting it off.
Yeah. Yeah, so definitely be in prayer for Mark Davis as The doctors are looking to do surgery, but he's not been in the best of health. So they're sort of waiting to find out if and when they can do the surgery. So, and normally at this point, I check my phone and tell Mike if there's anything online, and I'm having just check my phone and there's nothing else. Is there any other prayer requests? That is good to hear. So Betty Green has not been able to be with us for, it's almost been 3 months, yeah. Because of a heart issue, just not having energy to be able to do stuff. And she's finally able to go see a heart doctor this Tuesday. So that is a huge joy and continued prayer. Hopefully they can find out what it is and be able to fix it best. So, Brenda? Yes. Yeah, so Brenda Votal needs our prayer as she's still dealing with AFib, not having as much energy. Just continue to lift her up in prayer. And also, one of the things I include as a prayer request for her is that she slows down, not tries to overdo it, because often she works herself up and then ends up making the situation a little bit worse. So, but... I believe that's all of the prayer requests, so may you join me in prayer. Almighty Heavenly Father, we are grateful for all the lives that you have connected us with former pastors, former church members, and the fact that we are able to have that connection to them through you when we lift them up in prayer is a true, it's a true mystery that we cannot understand. It's a mystery that you, our Father, are listening to us right now, and not only listening to us, but acting on our behalf, because we have a lot of things on our hearts, many surgeries, many tests, many uncertain futures, all of which we need your guidance and your hand upon them. For those that are in need of healing, we ask for them to feel your healing spirit through the Holy Spirit, that you will intervene, give the doctors wisdom, and allow miracles to happen. And even with all these different things in our messy world, there is plenty to be joyful about. People celebrating graduations, families finding new homes, people getting to travel and visit with family. And we're so thankful for all the joys that you bring into our lives, and we know that it's a gift from you. So help us enjoy those gifts. And as we continue in our service, may our service continue to be filled with your praises. May we be continued to be filled with your joy. May we be healed through the hearing and proclamation of your word. May be with Mike as he delivers that message, as you've given that message to him, this word of patience, a word that we all need to hear. May we be patient with your patience, waiting on your timing and your wisdom in all things. And we ask this all now with the prayer that your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And at this point in time, I invite you to please stand and greet one another in the name of Jesus Christ.
a love vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the prince of a life, our ransom, shed for us his precious blood. Who is love will not remember, who can cease to sing his praise. He will never be forgotten throughout heaven's eternal day.
Just
all right, I haven't gotten to do this before. If you would find your way back to your seats at this time, please, we could continue the service now that the song's over. Good morning again, everyone. It's nice to be with you today. And boy, I tell you what, you miss one Sunday because you have to work, and the next thing you know, the pastor assigns you to do the message. So let that be a lesson to you all, okay? You want to make sure you're here each and every Sunday, okay? No, seriously, Nick did ask me several weeks ago to do this, with him having so much to do with annual conference this week and then also coming back to Bible school. It was quite a bit on his plate. And so since it was my turn in the rotation to get to deliver the message, it was on me. So, how many people like sitting at a red light? How many people enjoy that? Oh, I do have a couple of hands back there. According to Yahoo Finance,
Oh, and Lacey does too. From the time the average person turns 16 until, if you assume retirement at age 65, they spend over 4 months of their life sitting at a red light. That's quite a bit of time. It's a lot of, well, red lights are one of those things that definitely will test your patience. And me trying not to be below average or even average, I'm pretty sure that I have exceeded that probably by months as far as how much time that I spend at a red light. It's actually become a bit of a running joke in our family. So much so that this past year when we were on vacation, after a couple of days of riding around Siesta Key, Alexis's friend said, "Wow, I thought you were kidding when you said your dad hit every red light." So that's been something that for me has been a true test of patience pretty much since I began driving. And it's now that I'm carrying mail much closer to home and spend so much more time on Preston Highway, like I say, my 4 months is probably up to six and working on eight rapidly. So, and you know, anytime we get in a car, it can be a test of patience. You know, we're on vacation and you know, you always hear it, "Are we there yet? Are we there yet?" You know. Displaying patience is challenging, and learning patience is a challenge. We hear that patience is a virtue, that good things come to those who wait. So, you know, what is it about patience that makes it so important? Merriam-Webster tells us that patience is the quality of wait. I should have had that written down. I might have to pull up my phone for that one. Anyway, I'll try to paraphrase. But anyway, it's the quality of waiting. But Joyce Meyer, who's a Christian author, I like the way that she put it about patience. She says that patience is not the ability to wait, but how you act while you're waiting. So what you're doing while you're waiting, that's what patience is really about. So why does patience matter? You know, why is it so important that we wait and that we wait without complaining, you know, without acting, you know, hastily? And there were three things that occurred to me that, I'm sure they're not the only three things, but three things that occurred to me about why patience is so important. The first reason that occurred to me was that patience tells God that we trust Him, that we trust His plan, and that we trust His timing. You know, currently we live in an on-demand world. We want everything now, you know, and if you go to the internet, everything's about, you know, getting free shipping, having it here in 1 day, going to the store, and you can have your order, you know, waiting for you when you get there. Nobody wants to spend any time waiting for anything anymore. But if you think about some of the people that we've had, we've studied here in our sermon series just recently, Noah spent decades building the ark and preparing for the flood, you know, waiting for God's timing and plan on that. Decades, well, quite a bit of time. Abraham was 100 and Sarah was 90 when they had their first child. They waited 25 years for God's promise to have that child. That's a long time. That's a long time. There's an entire book of the Bible that we tend to reference whenever we talk about people who display extraordinary patience, the book of Job. And thinking ahead a little bit about some subject that I'm sure we'll touch in a few weeks, Joseph. Joseph endured trials and tribulations for more than a decade before he finally became Pharaoh's second in command and was reunited with his brothers. Much more recently in our church, one of the things that's tested our patience is the pandemic. And one of the big things that we've had to learn to do is to learn how to worship in this new world now. But look what it's done for our church as far as allowing us to improve our outreach. You know, now that we're online, we can reach people that we never could have reached even just 3 years ago. It's made us challenged for sure, but it's allowed us to expand our reach and to rethink the way that we worship and to be so much more inclusive with folks who can't be here each and every week. And folks that if you're traveling or for whatever reason, you know, you have the opportunity to be in worship service just as if you're sitting right down front here just like Pastor Nick is. Again, we live in an instant gratification world, online pickup orders. We have fast pass lanes now at the amusement park because nobody wants to stand in line to ride. You've got fast pass toll lanes because nobody wants to wait at the bridge. So there's plenty of ways that, you know, we have society have created it so that you can be impatient, so that you can hurry, so you don't have to wait. But the Bible, on the other hand, has several scriptures that we can turn to that reminds us that God's will is for us to slow down, to have endurance, and to trust His plan and His timing because He knows what He's doing. Philippians 4:6 tells us, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, With thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. Prayer and patience are in accordance. They go hand in hand. If you improve in one area, you'll improve in the other area. And the only way that you tend to improve a skill is to by practicing it, right? So the more you pray, the more you'll learn patience, and the more patience you learn, the better you'll be at praying. Romans 12:12 tells us to be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Again, prayer, faith, patience, joy, hope. All those things go together. We want to make sure that we're doing those together. Another reason why patience matters is because to be patient is to show mercy. To be patient is to show mercy. Having patience allows us to be put in a position to be merciful. Romans 8:25 tells us, but if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. One of the best stories that we're given in the Bible about patience and about hoping and waiting patiently and persevering is in Luke 15. And there's pull-out verses in your bulletin this week. The prodigal son. And I want to focus specifically on verse 20 in that story. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell around his neck and kissed him. His father had been waiting patiently. He'd been hoping. But he'd also been watching, okay? He wasn't just not doing something, okay? He was watching. He was watching and waiting. And when he saw his son, he showed him compassion. He showed him mercy. Okay, he learned that with patience. Okay, his father was patiently waiting, hoping for the day his son would return, and he was looking too. Okay, so we not only need to be patient, but we need to be prepared to act. Again, perseverance is the key, but it's vital to gaining the ability to display patience. Turning back to Joseph from the previous point, he too showed mercy, despite, again, about 13 years, if my memory serves, of serving trials and tribulations at the hands of his brothers and at the hands of, you know, being sold into slavery and all that he endured. But again, God rewarded him. He became Pharaoh's second in command. He was reunited with his family, and he forgave his brothers. Okay, he forgave his brothers. Okay, very difficult thing to do. Very difficult thing to do. Proverbs 15:18 tells us that a hot-tempered person stirs up conflict, but the one who is patient calms a quarrel. Okay, Joseph wasn't looking for a fight with his brothers, okay? Joseph got his reward from his patience from the Lord, and he was calm and quiet with his brothers and showed them mercy, just like God shows us mercy even when we're not deserving. And as a final thought, patience is required so that you may reap your rewards, both earthly rewards and your heavenly rewards. If we look in Galatians 9, it tells us, "Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not lose heart." Again, there's action required, okay? We have to persevere. We have to work faithfully, okay? And we do not have to lose heart. We must not lose heart, okay? We don't want to grow sluggish in doing good, okay? But our rewards, we can reap our rewards not only on earth, but also, more importantly, our eternal life in heaven. God has a plan, and in his time, he will reveal it. In his perfect timing, we'll be rewarded for our patience. So again, we must not lose heart. All those we mentioned earlier received abundant gifts from God while they were on earth. Abraham's descendants became as the grains of sand on the ocean, as the stars in the sky, as numerous. Okay, Noah was rewarded. He was able to survive the flood, and he and his family helped replenish the earth. Sarah and Abraham got their child. All those were mentioned got their abundant gifts from God for their faithfulness to him and to his plan. They displayed a pretty extreme amount of patience for most of us. Like I say, waiting decades for something is a difficult challenge indeed. The Bible tells us that we will also receive God's blessings if we wait patiently, if we endure patiently. In James 1:12, it says that blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. God has promised us eternal life, but we must be faithful, we must be patient, and we must do our good works without growing weary. Another verse that I really like is in Hebrews, verses 11 and 12. And we desire that each one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope until the end, that you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Now, inherit is one of the key words in these verses. If you think about the verses that Alexis read earlier in Psalm 37:9, it tells us that if we're patient, we will inherit the earth. Okay, we will receive earthly rewards for our patience. And then when we turn to James 1 here, he also tells us if we are patient, we inherit the promises, which are the promises of heavenly life as well. So patience not only grants us earthly rewards, but ultimately our eternal life in heaven. Just like the prodigal son, we have to be careful. We can spoil our inheritance, okay, if we act hastily and if we act impetuously. God is always faithful. God is patient and loving, and that is indeed our hope in the Lord. Let us act patiently. Let us act mercifully so that when our life journey is ended, it'll allow us to say, as Paul did in the end in 2 Timothy, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Amen.
So as we're about to sing our closing hymn, I have just one quick thought that I was just put together. I don't know why it came to my mind when you're speaking. But the parable of the prodigal son, you're bringing to our mind the father. And because our VBS theme, I'm the one teaching on God the Father at this point, I'm trying to think, how do we imitate the Father? And the song that we're going to be concluding our service with is a song called Forever. The Lord's patience is forever. God is waiting for each and every one of us, whenever we stray, for us to come back to him, because his love endures forever. May you please stand as we sing our final hymn, Forever. I will be singing the lead, and Mike will be doing the response for the congregation.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever.
And by the grace of God, we will carry on.
His love endures forever. Sing praise.
strong. Forever God is with us. Forever.
Well, church, thank you again. It's been a wonderful service. A quick reminder that you do have an outreach team meeting right after church over here, so it shouldn't take just a few moments. And now for the benediction. Now may the God of patience and comfort grant you to be like-minded toward one another according to Jesus Christ. Romans 15:5. Amen and amen.